The old town of Nablus in the West Bank. Shirin Nazal is a social worker. She is visiting families in villages south of Nablus where there are many Israeli settlements. Shirin encounters the same stress and anxiety during all her visits. 2 meters by 1 meters.
They are very tired because they couldn't sleep in the night. There is shift in the houses. The mother, when she is wake up, the father is sleeping. And after that, the father wake up, the mother is sleeping. Because they are worried from the settlers to go and to burn their house or broke the house.
That's how life is in the occupied Palestinian territories. Everyone here remembers the 18-month-old boy who was killed when Israeli settlers set fire to his home. That was back in July. The incident has deeply affected Wissem Asseyeh's patients.
The people watch TVs to follow the news, what's happened here and there, especially on the checkpoints near the settlements. The clashes with the soldiers and the settlers. A lot of injuries, a lot of killed people, martyrs, a lot of arrestation, high numbers than compared with the other months. The people now follow all these news and start to have more anxiety, more sleeping disorders. The children focus with the families also on the news, and it affects their concentration and their school performance.
In the past few months, the violence has increased yet again, and the repression is even more merciless. The people aren't sleeping properly, not only because of nightmares, but also because of the Israeli soldiers who storm into their homes day or night to interrogate and arrest them, including adolescents like this boy who was arrested for throwing stones.
For young people, they experience these daily humiliations. Their economic futures are really shortened in comparison to other adolescents. They watch their fathers and mothers humiliated. They're targeted for no reason other than their appearance. And watching this day after day, you know, you can imagine for any young person how that might really get you down. And, you know, you combine that with, you know, impulsivity and maybe a tendency to answer back or to fight back. The consequences can be deadly.
Offering support to those suffering from trauma caused by a conflict they're powerless to do anything about, such is the daily task of the psychologists, social workers and doctors working on MSF's program. Every day, volunteers come from France and neighbouring countries to help the refugees in the north of France to do what the state, quite simply, isn't doing.
I bring food given to us by shops. The people here are from Sudan, Eritrea and Ethiopia. There is nothing to fear from them. All you will get from them is their smiles and their friendship.
For about 6 weeks now, I've been working on allocating the building. We work with MSF. The most important thing is that there's a real perception in England that not enough resources are being expended by the government to help refugees all around the world. And so ordinary people, I think especially in England, have decided that it's their responsibility, it's their duty to help people.
This refugee from Pakistan is a nurse. He's been living in the jungle in Calais for 6 weeks. He helps treat the injured.
Something happened all the time. Happening is a night time, and police putting tear gas on refugees when he attempt to cross border. So at that time must be need somebody there who will be care in the injured patient.
Médecins Sans Frontières is also providing medical care in Calais and constructing shelters made of wood. The 1,500 accommodation places the government has promised are long in coming. Work on them has only just begun. As is the case across Kabul, the population in Dashti Bashi has exploded, and over 1 million people are now living in this neighbourhood. Private clinics here charge $90 for a normal delivery and $700 for a caesarean, a huge amount most families simply cannot afford.
Did she lay flat for 12 hours?
How can I do this?
Yes, she did.
Okay.
MSF has set up a fully equipped emergency obstetrics unit to help reduce mother and child mortality.
We tell them the baby is too big and it's not coming down. So we have tried everything. We're going to do a cesarean section.
The 45-bed facility has an intensive care unit for mothers and newborns, an inpatient ward, and an operating theatre for caesareans. There's an average of 800 deliveries at the Dashti Bashti Maternity Centre every month.
I think there's a tendency to see all the refugees as this uniform mass and like just like one type of person. You got people from all over the world who've got lots of different stories and lots of things they're running away from. The majority of the people we saw were coming from Syria and Iraq, and their stories were very similar. Depending on where they came from inside Syria or Iraq, they're very, very similar stories. But the people themselves were all very different. So you would see sort of like hipsters with piercings and tattoos. At the same time, you'd see people who lost all of their money in the water in Greece. You'd see people who would make jokes about how climbing through parts of Greece and Macedonia was like the Sound of Music. So for me, I think what strikes me is just they all kind of share the same path, but with very different stories leading up and very different perspectives on the whole experience. But what is uniform is this idea that it's supposed to be better at the end, whether they're going to Germany or whether they think that they're going to meet family in Belgium or wherever they want to end up. The idea is like we're all heading there. And that's the one thing I think that ties them together. But otherwise, it's a hugely different, a very heterogeneous like population, but all with this very intense sense of hope.